Check this out. This is Craig Brown. He's the pastor at a church in a small podunk town in Idaho that reaches tens of millions of people every single year through platforms like TikTok, Instagram, YouTube, and even his podcast. He's what he calls a digital missionary. What does that mean? Welcome to Bible Memory Gold. My name is Josh Summers. And in this week's interview with Craig, we talk about a lot of different things, including what it looks like in this new era of digital information to reach people with the gospel anywhere in the world from your home, from your computer or your phone, and what it looks like to be able to inspire people to read the Bible or, in his case, memorize different portions of the Bible, which is something he loves to do. So let's dive into this interview. You know, I was watching a video just earlier today from the Heart of the City Church, which I believe you're an elder at that church,
yeah,
where they were sending you out as what they're terming a digital missionary, which is something I've never heard before. And I'm just going to read a couple stats here, just because there may be people who are watching this or listening to this right now that don't know this. But in 2021, you had over 1.3, actually, I think right now it's up to like 1.4 million followers across platforms like Instagram, you know, YouTube, TikTok, and in a podcast that you have. You had 47 million views in 2021.
Yeah.
Like when you hear these numbers, like, which frankly are just numbers that are hard to believe, like, what does that make you feel?
You know, it's crazy. It's like nobody could have predicted this. And I didn't set out for that. I think though, for me, it's like when I really gave my life to Jesus and then he really got a hold of my heart and called me into the ministry. From the very beginning, before social media was even a thing, just like every pastor and missionary throughout history, the idea is influence, right?
Yeah.
We go on the mission field to influence a people group, or we start a work in a church to influence a people, that people would be influenced to Christ. And so that's always been my desire. And then, I just assume influence more rather than less. Not that smaller numbers or bigger numbers necessarily mean anything, but I want to influence as many people as possible. But when I got into the digital space, it wasn't like I was thinking I was going to be some social media celebrity or something. It actually started, I just was just being obedient to God, because I really felt like he said, just help people read the Bible and do it every day. And so it didn't start on TikTok. It started on YouTube, and it was a challenge from the Lord to post one video a day, every single day in 2020. And so that's what I did. And the second thing that was unique about it is he said, I don't care if more than one person watches, I want you to do it every day. And normally I'm the type of person that's like, you know, curse the fig tree. Like if a ministry is not bearing fruit, you know, it's like, cut it down, just do something else. But I just knew, it's like probably the first time in my ministry life where I really knew, keep doing this no matter what, if you think there's no fruit. And after 13 months, I had 1 million followers. And then, yeah, coming into the end of 2021, I never thought that I would step off of the staff at the church. Never. Mm-hmm. But coming to the end of 2021, we're looking at the numbers, and really honestly, more than just the big numbers, it's the questions that are coming in. It's the real relational engagement that people are engaging with that sort of just led us to say, I didn't do this. I couldn't do this. Jesus, you did this. So what do you expect from me? Like if you were sitting here right in front of me and I said, what do you want me to do with this? I can't respond to 10,000 messages, you know, what do you want? And we just kind of started to feel like he was saying, hey, what would it look like if you did what you're most gifted to do? Cause the local church is important, but to do what you're most called to do in the local church and then hand over the other things to other up and coming leaders and focus more on this. And so, yeah, when we think about 47 million views, it's humbling, it's exciting. I'm talking a lot, so let me just say one more thing. I don't know if I've ever said this on a podcast yet, but I remember when I was in college, and I went when I was in college between my junior and senior year, and I did 40 days of solitude, because I figured I'd never be able to do that again in my life after I got married and all that, and You know, Moses did it. Jesus did it. So I went in the woods alone and just praying that God would use me and all that. And I remember my prayer, probably like a lot of people, maybe you, you know, lots of people. I remember my prayer was, Lord, make me the next Billy Graham. I just want to be like the next Billy Graham. And then, you know, you get to a certain age and you're like, well, that's not happening. You know, it's kind of like when you're a kid and you want to be in the NBA and you're like, you know, elementary, oh, there's still a shot. Middle school, there's still a chance. High school, I could still do that. College, you're like, well, I'm not playing in college, but I mean, but then you get to this certain age where you're like, okay, I'm officially not making the NBA. Like, I recognize that at this point.
Yeah, exactly. You know?
And so there's like this point where I'm like, okay, you know, I'm not the next Billy Graham. And I think in my research, I'm pretty sure this is true, but I think he preached to about 215 million people, either live or on TV, which in his era is insane, right? And yes. And of course, Billy Graham is in a, you know, in league of his own. But what's crazy about that is I had the thought earlier this last year, and I thought, oh my goodness, it is actually potentially possible that some nobody from North Idaho can actually speak to 215 million people because of these crazy pieces of, you know, technology that you couldn't have even imagined years ago. And so we're living in a time that's unlike any other. The opportunity, the darkness is great for sure, but the opportunity to reach people all over the globe is insane. I have 150,000 followers in the Philippines. It's like, in what universe could somebody from North Idaho ever have 115,000 people from the Philippines that are caring what they're saying? So,
wow.
Yeah, it's been fun.
Unbelievable. Yeah, that is so crazy. I do think it is fascinating that we do live in a world where that kind of stuff is possible, right? Where something that you make in, I assume you're sitting in like your office or something in your house, is that right?
Yeah, it's my house, yeah.
Yeah. And I'm just sitting in a, like a small office that, like, if you were to drive by here in Thailand, just as it looks like nothing, it is pretty much nothing. It's a 3x3 meter box. And yet, the Lord can use the passions and the gifts that he's given you and, hopefully me as well in order to inspire, encourage, and even be like, I think I saw this, that you said that there were 145 commitments to Jesus, through the stuff that you'd done in 2021. Did I read that stat right?
Yeah. Yeah. What's crazy is actually 115 of those happened on Good Friday.
Oh, wow.
God is reaching people. Wow. And I think, especially in those ways, it's people that aren't necessarily in first world countries.
Yeah.
You know, people are hearing the message. Like I led a girl in Zambia to the Lord through Instagram DMs like a month ago. And then I always try and send people next steps if I can. And it's like, read the Bible, pray, get involved in a local faith community, you know, give money to that faith, you know, tithe. Serving a church, you know, stuff like this. And she's like, there's no church. There's no churches here. What should I do? You know? And it's like, this is what we're running into is there's here in America, it's like, yeah, there's churches. Just go find one. You know what I mean? But there's people all over the planet right now that have cell phones with internet, and some of them don't even have running water in their house or electricity, but they have these cell phones and they're connected globally. And then there's people that just don't have any, they don't have a church down the street to go to. So the opportunities are, you know, right now, vast to reach people.
Yeah, that is so cool. I mean, like, you do a lot of different, from what I've seen, like, you do a lot of different types of videos. Your YouTube channel, I think, is called Bible Time. And, like, I remember you've done some where you're just, like, it's almost like you're morning reading. Like, you're not preaching. You're reading along and kind of talking through what you're thinking. And then you do some where you're actually doing and memorizing. I think you call it memorization time. And, going through and you're memorizing some of those verses. Explain to me your thought process. Like, what are you trying to accomplish by doing that? And then where does Bible memory fit in your personal life?
Yeah. Like, what I was describing earlier, how this whole thing started was the YouTube thing. And the YouTube thing specifically was a daily devotional Bible reading. And I called it Bible Time because at the time, it seemed like the natural term would be Bible study. But I knew that I wasn't really doing a Bible study. The whole reason it started was because I get up in the morning and I try and read the Bible every day and meet with God and spend time with God. And so me and my wife will travel with this other couple. They're some of our best friends. And usually once a year we'll travel together. And in the morning I get up with my Bible and my pen and I read and underline, squiggly, circle, box, arrow, all that.
Yeah.
And our friend was like, this just stuck with me. The Lord just highlighted it. She said something like, man, I wish I could sit next to you every morning when you read your Bible, because I just don't know. Why do you underline? Why do you squiggly? Why do you? And then she said this, like something like, us normal people don't always know how to just read the Bible. And I'm thinking to myself, like, wow, like this is like food to me. Like this is like breathing to me. Like if I didn't, you know, man doesn't live on bread alone, but every word that comes from the mouth of God. Like if I didn't, you know, what would I do? And then I'm starting to realize there's just thousands of believers that just, the only time that they get the word is by listening to a sermon once a week. And it's like, so anyway, I knew that I didn't want to, probably also just didn't have the time, because I'm a preacher, you know, I'm a yeah. teacher and a theologian. So if I'm going to deliver a sermon or a message, I'm going to study, I'm going to try and make sure by God's grace that it's as theologically sound and perfect as I can. And so all that takes work. But I knew if I did this daily thing, it wasn't really. And so I said, I mean, pretty much people got annoyed with it. Every single video almost I said, hey, this is not a study, this is not a sermon, this is not pre-prepared. This is literally me just reading in the moment. All you're really doing is just eavesdropping on how I do my devotional. And the point of it is not so much to teach, although teaching happened, but it was to show people how I did it in hopes that they wouldn't need the videos anymore and they just would start doing it on their own. So yeah, the Bible Time stuff on YouTube isn't really teaching per se. It's just me doing my devotional. But yeah, like I think at the end of 2020, I did a lot more memorization in college. I started memorizing when I was a senior in high school, and that was when I actually started following Jesus. I called myself a Christian my whole life, but it wasn't until right before my senior year that I actually started following Jesus, got baptized, really repented and followed him. And then I was discipled by a Young Life leader, and he had us start memorizing. And it was the first time I ever did that. And he gave me these little cards, and it was cool because you actually like, you know, wow, I actually am learning something, you know? And then I did more in college. And then I remember in my freshman dorm, there was this challenge to memorize all of Philippians. So I did that with a couple guys, the full book of Philippians. And then, yeah, I got older and I just kind of got away from it a little bit. I still had a lot of it in the bank from those earlier days. And then I know a lot of the Bible, like generally what it says, because I've been reading it for half my life now and studying it. But I didn't continue like diligently memorizing as much. And then the end of 2020, I just got inspired again. And I specifically by this one gentleman here in our region. And he's a very successful businessman, banker, all this. And he was talking all about success. And he's like, you're probably thinking that I'm talking about a different kind of success than what I'm actually talking about. He says, you know, 13 years ago, I started memorizing the Bible every single day. And that's what's led to my success, because Joshua 1:8 says, do not let the book of the law depart from your mouth and meditate on it day and night. Be careful to do everything written in it. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. And so I was like, yeah, man, he relit the fire in me. And then I preached a sermon on memorization and challenged the church to do it. And then I was like,
nice.
You know what? I should probably do it if I'm challenging everybody. So I gathered a little group of people together. And I was also spurred on by, I saw David Platt's sermon.
Yes.
And did you see this one?
Where he just started to 30
seconds
it.
And then the whole sermon is just him quoting Romans 1-8. I was like, yep. Let's do it. Let's do it. So I started memorizing Romans 1 through 8 January 1st, 2021 with a group of 8 people. By the time we got done, there was 3 of us and we all barely finished, and I don't have it all down perfect now. But anyway, so what happened in that season, to wrap up your question, I remembered back in college this tool that was the best tool for me. Now, I know that there's different techniques, but for me, it made my memorization 100 times faster, which is a note card, writing the verse on one side, flipping it over, and writing just the first letter of each word on the back side. That tool was I assume a lot of your audience has heard of this. If they haven't, you should try it. Because what it does for me is, most people, when they try and memorize, it's like they read something and, like, if you will, they have 100% of the information just right there for their brain. There's no work in the brain. And then they hide it. And then they have 0% of the information and they're trying to, like, remember it. So for me, the one letter thing is almost like, it's like you have all the information and then you have 50%, but it's enough information where it's a hint, but then your brain builds that synapse. Like, that A is apostle, you know what I mean? And so then you hide it and it's like, dude, it goes so quick. And then it's exciting because it's like, wow, you can memorize a verse. So that's what I did when I preached the sermon. I literally had the whole church memorize a verse together. Psalm 1, I think we did 1 through 3. And I was like, look, you guys, we spent 5 minutes doing that and you guys all memorized it. Some of you probably would have walked in today saying, oh, I can't memorize, my memory's bad. And we just did it together. So just try this. Anyway, so I looked all over for a digital tool of that flashcard. Couldn't find one. My brother makes websites. I literally was like, dude, build me a website. He built me this cheapest little website to basically do that. You hit a button and it makes all the words just the first letter, but it was just not that good. And then I was literally about ready to pay somebody to make it, build an app or something. And I found these guys called the Verse Locker. Have you heard of the Verse Locker?
Okay. Isn't that Scripture Memory Fellowship?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so looking back, I'm like, man, I wonder if Scripture Memory Fellowship is the, I wonder if that's who the cards were back in high school, because I know that they do the little cards with the little pouch you can put the cards in. And that's what I had in high school. So it might have been from them. Anyway, so I reached out to them and I was like, you guys, listen, I already want to promote you for what you do. And they're like, hey, yeah, well, so we did this little thing together. And I was like, I just want people memorizing the Bible. And if I can promote your company and this app, then hallelujah. And we did a little deal together. So that's what the memorization time videos were from. I'm hoping that people would hide the word of God in their heart, because it's just invaluable to know it.
Yeah. You know what I'm really taking away part of what you're saying there, because it's true of me, and so many people have seen that David Platt video. I'm pretty sure John Piper's done something very similar to that.
Yeah,
And there's this feeling that I get where I feel like memorization is a very personal thing, this thing that I'm supposed to just do quietly on my own, and it feels weird to sometimes even have this YouTube channel or this community where I'm talking about it all the time. And yet it's because of this gentleman that's the businessman you're talking about, he inspired you to get back into it. Like it takes people who are willing to be vocal about what they find important to inspire other people to do it as well. And that's what I'm even seeing, from you and what you get to do on the platforms that you're on is, it's not about yes, it is your face. And there's something weird about, to me at least, there's something weird about constantly having my face on something. And yet it is the ability to be able to inspire people by just showing them this is what I believe, so much so that I'm willing to kind of just forget any type of put myself out there and let you know that I think this is really important. So I love that. So for you, the primary method for you is these cards, or I guess now maybe even the digitized version with Verse Locker. Is it really just a lot of repetition, or how exactly do you go about working through some of these verses as you've memorized them?
So just practically speaking, what do I do?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so I did a couple things. So for me, memorizing one verse or a couple verses is relatively easy. You know, if I use the app, yeah, like my brain, that works pretty quickly with my brain to just, you know, read it a few times and then do the first letter thing and then get it down. When I started memorizing Romans 1 through 8, it was like chapter 1 was cool, that's easy. But then you start adding chapter on chapter and Paul's like saying some of the same stuff and and then it's long and it's deep. Then some of the, you know, this is some of the deepest theology. And so it just got to be like difficult, man. Yeah. And I'm getting older now. so part of what, yeah, part of it, whereas in the past, maybe I didn't think that just the straight repetition was as important. So I downloaded this other app. I think it, there's probably a bunch of them, but I downloaded an app called Jam Looper or something. It's like an instrument app. It's like an app that guys would like get a guitar and play a loop.
Yeah.
Yeah. Play a thing and then they'll hit it and then it'll keep going while they play something else. Mm-hmm. And I got it because I wanted, so what I would do in the morning is I would read the passages I'm supposed to memorize for the day. And I would read it into the looper because even the memo app on the iPhone, once the recording gets over, you got to hit start again. I just wanted to hear it over and over, and I wanted to hear myself saying it in my tone, my inflection, the rate that I would probably quote it in. So I would read the verses of the day, and then I'd put that thing, that loop on, and my whole drive to work, I would hear myself say that verse. Yeah, just over and over and over and over again. So I combined those two things. Those were my two main ways of memorizing is the first letter thing, either on a note card or on the Verse Locker app, and the loop of just hearing it. Over and over and over. And then I guess really practically then the group that I was doing it with was a big part of it too. Actually, now that I'm thinking about it, I would say that's a huge part of it. If I literally just said to myself, I'm going to memorize Romans 1 through 8 just alone, man, I don't think I would have made it as far as I did, but we had this group. We had to, do you know what Marco Polo is?
Yes.
So we had a deal.
You can just, yeah.
Yeah, it's basically like a video messaging app. Mm-hmm. And so we had a deal with each other. You had to, whatever chapter we were in, you had to do that chapter from verse 1 down to whatever verse we were on every Sunday on Marco Polo before midnight on Sunday. And so having that accountability of people doing it with you and having to quote, we call it sound off. You have to sound off. So if I'm supposed to be through verse 18 in chapter 5, I don't have to do all chapters 1 through 4, but I have to do 5, 1 through 18 this Sunday. But then like once a month, we would do everything up to wherever we are in the book, you know? And so, yeah, I guess I would say that's it. That's actually a huge part. If you memorizing alone, you should do it and it's cool. But if you could find some people that want to do it with you, like your community, you know, I'm sure that you guys have community going on, people challenging each other and you know that you're not doing something alone. It just helps a ton. So
it absolutely does. Yeah. And I think it's just that level of accountability that, you know, even, I mean, I'm not going to, I don't know for you guys, when you did that with the Marco Polo app, if you hadn't finished up to a point, like you just, I guess, do whatever you could, or how did that work? Or was the level of accountability that high?
Yeah. I mean, it was good to have it feel pretty high because then you really felt like, man, I really needed, but there were times when, you know, you didn't have it all. And so we'd be, you know, sometimes occasionally we'd each like look down at our Bible or something and be like, yeah, you know, and then just keep going, you know, nobody's like throwing stones at each other or anything.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, man, Craig, you've been awesome. I really appreciate you giving your time. I'm obviously going to have links to, you know, your YouTube channel, TikTok, Instagram, even your podcast, which you guys have. Is there anything else? Where else can we find you, or what are the things that are really going on that you're proud of and you want to share?
Yeah, I mean, the places people can find me mainly are, Instagram, TikTok, YouTube, the Thematic Podcast, and then the website for the ministry was supposed to be done already. You know, it's just taking time, but LogicosMinistries.com should be up soon. Okay. Yeah, we stepped full time into this itinerant preaching and digital missions April 1st. And so
yep.
We're raising money, like I don't have a salary anymore. And so we're just trying to just figure out what the Lord wants us to do. So
I hope you enjoyed this interview with Craig Brown. You can find links to all of his social media channels and to his new ministry and ways you can support him in the description below this video. If you'd like to watch even more great interviews with people who are inspiring, encouraging you to memorize more of the Bible, you can do so here. Thank you so much for watching, and God bless.